Good morning.
Good morning.
I am so pleased to have the opportunity to stand before you this morning on this Sabbath morning and welcome you to this worship service. I welcome members and friends of our faith community, and I'm still learning who is who, who's whom. Anyway, so if you're new to us this morning, we're very, very glad that you are here. And you are not a stranger, you are not a visitor, you are our guest. In the spirit of welcome, I looked out my office window, and not 4 feet away, straight down in the ground, she couldn't see me, otherwise she would have flown away. It was the lovely gray catbird. I'm a bird person. I'm not an expert, but I'm a bird person. I hadn't seen a gray catbird in years. They're not even that rare, but I hadn't seen one. And gray catbirds are lovely slate gray, and on the top there, they have a black furry head. And I want to tell you, that gray catbird was making herself welcome and at home in our churchyard. In that spirit, we come together. I want to remind you that there should be yellow prayer cards in front of you, and during the beginning time of the service, if you have a prayer you'd like to be lifted up later in the service by me, I'll be happy to do that. Just fill that out and give it to the usher. And also, lastly, remind you that we are celebrating the Sacrament of Holy Communion in the service, so hopefully you have your little communion piece. As we come together to worship now, hear these words attributed to Martin Luther. Our Lord has written the promise of resurrection, not in the books alone, but in every leaf in springtime. Let us come together now in the worship of God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. Rise as you are able and willing, and let us read responsively the call to worship together. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, the faithful ones. Sing praises to the Lord. Give thanks to God. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. Sing praises to the Lord. Sing praises to the Lord. Let us sing praises to the Lord by turning to hymn 83. Join me in the prayer of invocation. Our Lord has written the promise of resurrection, not in the books alone, but in every leaf in springtime. O living Spirit of Christ, we turn to you. Prune in us what needs to be pruned. Rise up in us what needs resurrection. Every leaf in springtime cries out in joy. So may we, Lord, when we rise to you. O God, write the promise of resurrection on our hearts so that we can cry out in joy with the springtime leaf. Amen. Please now greet one another in whatever way feels comfortable to you with the signs of peace and love.
Thank you. morning.
Good morning.
Any children
of any age are welcome to come join me down here. You know, we like to have fun. All right. So did anybody hear the thunder last night? Yeah, did it wake you up? Woke me up for a little bit. But do you know that after Easter, way back when, Jesus went to the Sea of Galilee and he helped his disciples catch a lot of fish? And you know the water that those fish were swimming in back then is still here in the world? That water may have been the water that fell last night during the rainstorm. All the water in the world is all the water in the world. And water is essential for life on earth. So we're going to follow the water on its journey around the earth today with a book that's called All the Water in the World. It's by George Ella Lyons and illustrated by Catherine Tillotson. All the Water in the World. Is all the water in the world. Water flows from the hose. It wobbles in blue pools. It fills your cup up. But where does it come from? Water doesn't come, it goes around. That rain that cascaded from the clouds and meandered down mountains, that wavered over waterfalls, then slipped into rivers and opened into ocean, that rain has been here before. Oops. Let's see if we can. There we go. Thirsty air licks the water from lakes, sips it from ponds, guzzles it from oceans. And this wet air swirls up till it's crowded into clouds where it hangs hotly around till cool air bumps through. And honey, these clouds just let it go. And rain, rain, rain. Tap dance, avalanche, stampede of drips and drips and drumming. A wealth of water. But far away, it's a different day. No sound but wind. Empty cup again. Dry grasses rustle. Dirt's just dust. Everything waits for an open gate in a wall of clouds, for rain sweet and loud to fill the well and start the stream. Honey, living things dream of water for all to drink, use in tub or sink, wash in, splash in. This wet wonder means grow, means life will flow through tigers, through trees. Through you and through me. All together now, all. Keep earth green. Now I wonder, how long does it take for water to journey around the world? I wonder if you feel connected now a little more to Jesus and his disciples, since you could be seeing the same water he did. And right now, I wonder where that water is. So to help you remember the story, I have, thanks of course to Miss D, some fish jumping out of water and jumping out of a net, just like the disciples had. And I think there's going to be more talk about fish today. And we're going to talk more about fish today too. So let's find our left hand and our right hand. Dear God, thank you for the gift of all the water in the world. Help us to use it wisely. Help us to keep it pure and clean. Amen.
Our scripture readings this morning begin with Psalm 30. Hear these words from the psalmist. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and did not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you brought up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, God's faithful ones, and give thanks to God's holy name. For God's anger is but for a moment. God's favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. By your favor, O Lord, you had established me as a strong mountain. You hid your face. I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, so that my soul may praise you and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. And now our gospel reading from John chapter 21, the first 14 verses. You might suspect it has something to do with fish. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we'll go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. Seems kind of backwards, right? But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. We join now together to sing our centering hymn, and if you've looked ahead, you may have noticed that it's Amazing Grace, a hymn that's familiar probably to everybody in this room. Probably many of us have sung this hymn hundreds, if not thousands of times in our lifetime. And it's easy when we get familiar with something like this to just kind of go through it by rote and forget what it's about. Have you ever noticed that there's little notes at the bottom of the hymns? I was reading this while I was preparing, and I noticed that the author of this hymn wrote this, as you can see here, it reflects his conversion from his earlier existence as a slave trader. I think that's a pretty important piece of background for this hymn. I don't know that I ever knew that before. But as we sing this hymn this morning, let's sing it from a new perspective, realizing the person who wrote this had a radical conversion to a whole different way of life, an offer that still stands for us and perhaps we've experienced ourselves. So please join me, rise please, and join me in singing together this familiar hymn from a new perspective today. Please be seated. And thank you, Hannah, for doing that song justice this morning.
Thank you, Heather, for reminding us. Indeed, John Newton was a wretch. He was, and he knew it. And hence his hymn. The Big Catfish. The Big Catfish happened on one of the best days of my life. The passage from John that Heather just read for us is another post-resurrection story. John tells us it's the third time that Jesus appears to the disciples in his gospel. A post-resurrection story. That's what you and I are. We are post-resurrection people. The Messiah is coming, but probably not today. We are post-resurrection people. And we are called to look for the living Spirit of Christ. And I'm standing here in this pulpit and I'm saying that you're probably not going to see Jesus of Nazareth in the flesh today. I mean, the actual historical figure. So in the meantime, as post-resurrection people, we are called to look for the living Spirit of Christ in each other, even in a wretch like John Newton. He was a master on those slave ships. He probably murdered slaves. He certainly whipped slaves. And we are called to look for the living Spirit of Christ in each other and in the world. And when we see it, we celebrate it. When we don't see it, we bring it. It's a fairly simple concept, and it's really, really hard. The disciples are seeing Christ, but are about to say goodbye to the flesh. They are saying goodbye to Christ in the flesh and hello to Christ in the Spirit, just like us. By some accounts, minutes before he was to die, Socrates said this: "You will bury my body, you won't bury me." Was he right? I just quoted him. "You will bury my body, you won't bury me." Eventually, Jesus left them in the body. And he lives on in you, and he lives on in me. I love this reference to 153 fish. What's the point of that? The reason why I love it is, if you read all the scholars, it's amazing, they all agree. You know what they agree on? They have no idea what that number means. None whatsoever, except for this: abundance. Abundance. When Christ enters into the equation, we receive grace in abundance. I didn't realize I was going to be talking about John Newton. Heather, thank you. He received grace in abundance, even him. That's what the 153 means. And the net doesn't break, which means there's more coming. Abundance. We receive grace, we receive courage, we receive love. We receive them all in abundance. You might have noticed that the John passage begins in the English translation, and it's correct. It's accurate. It says that Jesus showed himself. That's a phrase to pay attention to. It's very different than saying Jesus appeared or Jesus showed up. Jesus showed himself. The Greek word is phaneru. Phaneru, and it means to reveal. And what does reveal mean? It means revelation. Jesus revealed himself. Jesus was a revelation to them that day on the beach. And this is exactly what our calling is, to show ourselves to each other in the world. Today, when you get home and you see the rest of your family that aren't here today, you walk in the room and you smile and you say with great power and confidence, I am here to reveal myself to you because I am a revelation. Tomorrow at work, tomorrow at school, walk into the classroom, walk into the boardroom, and attention everyone, I am revealing myself to you because I am a revelation. The living spirit of Christ. Maybe this is not a good idea. But maybe it's a good idea to live it. To live. Jesus showed himself. We show ourselves. What I'm lifting up and what I've been thinking about all week and I've been thinking about Jesus showing himself, revealing himself. And the fact that very soon it was all over. The physical part of it was all over. And it has been ever since. And the Messiah is coming, but probably not today. So what do we do in the meantime? This morning I'm going to lift up a person in my life who came before me and lived in abundance. He revealed himself to everyone around him. And I'm asking you to think about the people who have come before in your life. And I'm giving you an assignment. And I want you to do this, and you don't have to turn it in. When you do assignments for me, you don't have to turn it in. The assignment is for you. Take a few minutes today. You can even do it now. Take a few minutes today and write down on a piece of paper the names of the people that have come before you in your life and lived abundantly. And revealed themselves to you and taught you how to live. One of those people that came before me and now is gone physically forever, who lives inside of me, is my cousin Bill. My cousin Bill was 2 years older than me, and my cousin Bill lived abundantly. He never sat still. We were second cousins. Our two mothers were first cousins, daughters of sisters. And cousin Bill lived in Belle Vernon, Pennsylvania, along the Monongahela River, where my mother is from. She's from Manesson, Pennsylvania. Across I-71 is Belle Vernon. And one summer when I was 14 and Bill was 16, we went to Pennsylvania for a summer visit, and Bill rode back with us to spend a week with us in Marysville. It was one of the best weeks of my life. And I'm telling you today about one of the best days of my life. Bill never shut up. He talked constantly, always laughing, always living. Bill didn't just exist. He lived abundantly. He drove my mother, who was driving the car, he drove my mother crazy with his tape recorder. Some of us remember tape recorders. Bill loved the Beatles. He loved Elton John. And to this day, when I hear the song Rocket Man by Elton John, I think of Bill over and over again in the car. Here's the day. One day we got up and we decided we were going to go fishing. And Bill didn't have a driver's license yet, so I got on my bike and Bill got on my older brother Jeff's bike, and we rode the mile or so outside of town to Dr. McIver's farm, who was a family friend, my dad's best friend in the church, really, Dr. Malcolm McIver. And if you were a member of the Grote family, you were allowed to go to the farm and mess around anytime you wanted to. There was a big farm pond. So there Bill and I were riding our bikes, right hands holding fishing rods, pedaling to the edge of town along Route 36. You pull in left. By the way, the farm is gone now. It's a Kroger. But I look at that Kroger, I still see that pond. You can physically kill the farm pond, but it still lives on. And we rode our bikes in, and there was a rowboat, and we got in the rowboat, and we rowed that boat out to the middle of the big farm pond, cast our lines, red and white bobbers, night crawlers on the hooks. And we just talked and were together. After a little while, I looked. I've never been much of a fisherman. After a little while, I looked, and my bobber was gone. And I thought, huh. And I pulled, and there was a fish on the end of the line. And that fish took us from one side of the pond to the other for about 45 minutes. And I kept reeling. Now remember, I'm talking about the people in our lives who have taught us how to live abundantly, like the Christ. And we finally, I kept reeling and I saw the bobber, and that means the fish is getting close, and we finally saw the face of that, what turned out to be a 24-inch catfish. We looked at that face and we said, there's no way we're getting that beast in this boat with us. So we rowed to shore and I dragged that poor fish up. This was back in the dark ages. We didn't have cameras and we knew nobody would believe us. With God as my witness, we rode our bikes back to my house, my left hand holding my rod and my right hand holding the fish. I can still see the looks of the people driving by in their cars. We got home, nobody was home. So I naturally put the fish in the kitchen sink. And after a little while, my mom got home. I was 14 years old. It was the first time I ever heard her curse. She essentially said, get that fish out of the sink. My dad showed up, my brother and sister showed up. We were very excited. And now I was starting to turn, and I started to turn from a great, well-known, world-famous sportsman to compassion for the fish. And we all said, let's get the fish, amazingly was still alive. Let's get this fish back to the pond. So we hopped in my mom's car. The fish was in a big pail. And it was like a Disney movie. We put the fish, I can still see it, put the fish in the water, didn't move, until finally, slowly, he swam away. I loved Bill. And a couple of years after that, Bill graduated from high school and joined the U.S. Air Force on the delay entry program. He was going to go in the Air Force in a couple of weeks. It was a hot summer day. And the story is that he and a couple of buddies decided to go swimming in the Yaquegainy River, which was near their house. They were playing frisbee. And actually two of them got into trouble. And Bill got trapped. And they found him under a big rock. And he was gone. And I'm not saying this story to make us sad, although it's sad. I'm going to take a few minutes today and write down the names of the people in my life who taught me about abundant living. And their bodies are gone. Their bodies are buried, but their spirits are not. That's what the disciples were up against. And that's what you and I are up against. And I'll end with this. Psalm 30 is, we're said it's a song of thanksgiving. It's a song of thanksgiving. And that wonderful phrase written in the King James Version, as God intended, goes like this.
I'm kidding about that. No inclusive language in there. I'm kidding about that. But this line, I think God did intend this line to be written in the King James. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And you and I, today, because of those who have come before, some of them members of our faith community, we can live our lives as songs of thanksgiving. Our life today can be a song of thanksgiving. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Thank you to all who have come before. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We come now to our time of prayer together, and I will be pleased to share any of the prayers that are written down today. I'll lift these up and then give us the gift of silence, and out of the silence we will come together in the Lord's Prayer. We enter into prayer now, and we lift up prayers of comfort and peace for my brother Rob and my sister-in-law Sharon as they wait for more tests about Rob's possible cancer. I'm still on a learning curve here. Should I read the person's name? Is that the custom? Somebody? Yeah? Okay. You probably know Beth Marler. Prayers of thanks as Mom Diane heals from a recent AFib diagnosis and a hospital stay. Betsy. Guidance for upcoming decisions, Valerie. Prayers for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. May we hold them in our hearts, and may God truly hold them in the palm of their hand. Please, please waken the minds and hearts of all people to the extreme crisis of climate change. So strong actions to save our precious home, Mother Earth, Ellen. Prayers of promise and thanksgiving for new life and new beginnings, exclamation point. Praying for Becky Chenault and wishing her a happy birthday surrounded by the love of family and friends, Susan Yudsey. Prayers for Tyler Adam and Lonnie Anderson, Susan and Jay Yutzi. I got to spend some wonderful time with the men at Templed Hills yesterday, and I led them in an exercise of sharing their favorite Bible story or Bible verse and why. So I pray for their safe return and safe travels. Let us come together now in a moment of silent prayer. Living and loving God, we give deep and profound thanks for the opportunity to come together in this holy place that points to the holiness of all creation, to gather at this holy place and pray and sing and be joyful, and listen for your word. You have heard our prayers, and we know that you especially hear those that are written in bold letter on our hearts. Hear us now as we lift our many voices as one voice and pray the Lord's Prayer together, saying, Our Mother and Father God, art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is our weekly offering time, and as I am usually called to do, it's a time to remind myself and to remind all of us. And indeed, along the lines of the abundance, gifts of Christ, that you and I are called to be generous. Generous in the giving of our time, generous in the giving of our talents, and generous in the giving of our treasure. And in that spirit, we lift up the opportunity to give our offering. Risen Christ, bless these gifts and grant them Godspeed. May the hands of the givers be your hands. May the feet of the givers go where you point. Amen. Be known to us in breaking bread, our hymn of preparation. We come now to the celebration of the sacrament of Holy Communion, and I lift up in grace and in thanks that we are about to celebrate open communion, which means all persons of all backgrounds, regardless of background, are invited to receive this sacrament. It is true, I believe, that Christ would turn away no one who wanted to receive, and in this way we celebrate and come together and eat together at table as one. So I lift up to you now the words of institution as they were first recorded for us by the Apostle Paul, who said that on the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And he said, Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same manner, again after giving thanks, our Lord Jesus Christ took the cup and he poured it out. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you. Take, drink all of it. As often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's life." Let us pray. Living and loving God, we lift up to you now through prayer and supplication these simple elements of bread and cup. And we ask you that you set them apart, grant them your grace, so that as first bread and then cup pass our lips, they may enter our souls, and we may receive the new life of Christ. We pray this in your name, saying, Amen. Got it. Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, he said, "Take, drink. This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you." Let us pray. Lord God, we are grateful. We are grateful that we have dined together at your table. We are grateful that we have received the new life of Christ, and we are grateful that we are ready now to leave this place transformed as your disciples. Amen. I was told, but I don't want to name any names. Oh, here he is.
Lynn goes away for a weekend and everything goes... It's out of it. So thank you to Heather for being our liturgist, and Roger and Hannah for our wonderful music, and thanks to Tess for being our AV person solo today. The Wednesday book study continues this Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Zoom. There's going to be a board of directors meeting this Wednesday at 7 p.m. to review the new policies and procedures manual, and Sandy Flohner will facilitate that meeting on Zoom. The Bread Nehemiah Action Meeting is coming up on Tuesday, May 10th at 7 p.m. Once again, we'll be back in person at the Celeste Center, and we'll have more information about carpooling soon. It's time for the produce market again. Just North is partnering with Wesley Church of Hope and other community activists to distribute tons of food each month. The first event will be Saturday, May 14th at 10 a.m. The Church of Hope is at 2935 Beulah Avenue. And if you need more information, you can contact Tess or Tim Delamater. And now Joyce has an announcement.
Did you ever want to be a flag? Well, as I suspect you know, we are joining with other faith communities in supporting the concert, the benefit concert to support the Ukraine War Relief Fund. You've heard from Lynn, you got a flock note from me. It's on our website, it's on our Facebook page. We're doing a great job of getting the word out, and now it's on the back page of your bulletin. You can never do too much to communicate, because we get our news in different forms. So now you have it in person. So it's highlights. It's this Wednesday, same night as the special board meeting. It's a busy night. To the Davidson Theater, which is in the Rife Center, some of our favorite performers who were with us for Concerts for a Cause pre-pandemic. So, of course, Arcady Gibbs and Alex Gordez. Arcady lives here. Alex Gordez is in, I believe, Nashville. He's coming up. They're both Ukrainian. Sean Booker, who's a blues singer. She rocked it when she was here that night. And, of course, Eric Nesda will be our MC. And they will be joined by the International Columbus Children's Choir, and they are breathtaking. And a Ukrainian folk ensemble from the Grace Evangelical Church. Since we've received donations to pay for the performers, and Kappa is donating the space, every penny is going to go to the War Relief Fund. And Tess and I took a trip down to Grove City to look at Grace Evangelical Church, which is where they collect donations. They load up the semis, they drive them to Cleveland. They said their first shipment cost them $30,000. So they have found an airline who's doing it for free now. And so they fly them to Poland. They're working with churches in Poland who then drive the medical supplies, the food, the clothing into Ukraine, which is very dangerous. As you saw in the press release, three volunteers have already lost their lives in this effort. So we hope that you will join us Wednesday night. Parking is free at the Rife Center after 6 o'clock. So please come, and if you can't, there's a way to donate. The link is in the bulletin. There's also I'm learning about QR codes. My grandkids gotta teach me things. So you donate in advance. You can do that, or just contact me. I'm listed as contact. And as I said, the band is back together. The volunteers who did Concerts for Car. It's just so wonderful, so fun with Tess and Eric and Leslie, and I call them the Erics, both of them. So please join me in Stand for Ukraine Wednesday night.
As you leave today, just be sure to take anything you brought in with you out with you, and happy Sunday.
Please, if you are able, rise and come together for our sending hymn, You Servants of God, Your Sovereign Proclaim.
Thank you.
Go forth now having received the new life of Christ. Go forth remembering you are free to choose any road, and any road you choose, Christ will walk with you. And go forth always remembering, follow your dreams, not your fears. In the name of God, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.